Welcome to a new episode of Ausfahrt.tv in what I call English, and I'm your host, Mr. Z. So welcome, we are back in Bielefeld after our little tour to Los Angeles and South Africa and Austria. Well, the weather is not as nice, but we have a cool car here for you, the Mercedes-Benz GLC, the mid-size SUV from Mercedes-Benz. If you haven't seen our reviews before, I might tell you that the description text of this video is pretty important. First of all, you find all the technical information about this car in the text. Second, our reviews are pretty long, up to an hour even, and it's always separated, our reviews are always separated in the same sections, so you can jump from section to section if one section is not interesting for you. Or you say, well, an hour review, whoo, too long, we'll just watch two sections today and two sections tomorrow. And if we have competitors already reviewed, you will find the links in the description text as well. Well, the GLC is a complete new car, but actually it has a successor. What we used to know as a GLK is now called the GLC. In early 2015, Mercedes-Benz announced that they will rename the whole SUV product range to make it more simple. The GLK, already based back in 2008 on the current C-Class, and so it makes sense to name the GLK GLC now, because it's the same, well, same platform than the current C-Class. The first GLK was introduced in 2008. It got a facelift or mid-cycle update in 2012, and by 2015 they presented the all-new version. That's the model we are showing you right now. Of course, we got quite a few competitors in the mid-size SUV segment. Even if you look just on the premium manufacturer, we have the Volvo XC60, the BMW X3, and from Volkswagen the Audi Q5, the Porsche Macan and the Volkswagen Tiguan. For the product start, Mercedes-Benz is offering three different powertrains for the GLC. We got two diesel engines, the 220d with 170 horses, the 250d with 204 horses, and a gasoline engine, the 250 with 211 horses. All the models come with a new 9G-tronic automatic transmission and the all-wheel drive by Mercedes called 4MATIC. Well, Mercedes-Benz will offer more powertrains in the near future. They plan a very small diesel, the 200D with 136 horses, and then two performance models. Well, you might know Mercedes splitted the AMG line sort of from the AMG sub-brand. So we will have a GLC 450 Sport AMG with 367 horses, and the real AMG, the Mercedes-AMG GLC 63 with 476 horses. And Mercedes is rolling out their plug-in hybrid thing more and more. So we expect a plug-in hybrid GLC later this year, 2015 still. The GLC 350e, and this comes with a system power of 320 horses. And here it is, the heart of our testcar, 2.2 liter inline four-cylinder common rail diesel engine with 204 horses. It's good for maximum torque of 500 newton meters, and you get them in a range between 1600 and 1800 rpm. As I said, our test car got the 9G tronic automatic transmission and the 4MATIC all-wheel drive. Okay, once again, here's the basic specs for the Mercedes-Benz GLC 250d. It accelerates from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour or 62 miles per hour in 7.6 seconds, and the top speed is reached at 222 kilometers per hour or 138 miles per hour. The gas tank of our test car is good for 66 liters. By factory settings, you get a smaller tank of 50 40 liters. 66 liters equals 17.5 gallons. Mercedes-Benz claims a fuel consumption of 5.5 liters on 100 kilometers or 42.7 miles per gallon, which means that under perfect conditions you can drive up to 1200 kilometers or 740 miles without getting gas. In terms of CO2 emissions, the 2050 Mercedes-Benz GLC 250d 4MATIC sets free 143 grams per kilometer, according to Mercedes-Benz. The Mercedes-Benz GLC has a length of 4.66 meters, which equals 183 inches, with a wheelbase of 2.87 meters, which equals 113 inches. It is 1.64 meters high, so 65 inches, and 1.89 meters wide, so 74 inches. From mirror tip to mirror tip, it's even 2.1 meters, so 83 inches. As of the turning circle, you need at least 11.8 meters or 38.7 feet of free space. The curb weight is 1845 kilograms or 4068 pounds. The admissible total weight is 2500 kilograms or 5512 pounds. As we are talking about an SUV here, let me add the off-road specs as well. The ground clearance is 181 millimeters or 7 inches. The approach angle 21.7 degrees. The angle of departure 23.1 degrees. The ramp angle is 16.9 degrees and the tilt angle is 35 degrees. The gradability is by 70%. The rating depth is 300 millimeters. In Germany, our test car would cost around about 70,000 euros. The GLC is a complete new car. By the way, it lost weight up to 80 kilograms. And while the GLK always reminded me of the smaller brother of the Mercedes, of the mighty Mercedes G-Class, the new look of the Mercedes SUVs is more rounded, you know, more flowing and not so edgy like the GLK used to be. So in terms of aerodynamics, the GLC is much better than the GLK. While the GLK had a CD value of 0.34, the GLC now has a value of 0.31. And of course, it has a new face of all the Mercedes-Benz SUVs now. If you see the GLE, the GLE Coupe, the GLS and the GLC, they all look similar from the front regarding the signature of the front lights, excuse me, as well as the grille design. So we have this double wing or double blade grill here now with a big Mercedes-Benz star. I told you already we have a new light signature for the SUV models, and our test car is even equipped with the optional LED intelligent light system. Every time the same. So we got not only LED day running lights, but full LED headlights. They do the cornering stuff. They look for the traffic ahead of you and so on and so on. Besides that, the GLC comes with three different trim levels. Our trim level is called Exclusive Line, and you can get them in a combination with two other packages, the off-road package and the AMG line package, but our test car does not have one of them. I told you the design of the Mercedes-Benz SUV models got a little bit more flow, and while the GLK was rather one and a half box design, here we see now from the side it looks a little bit even like a coupe-like shape, at least to me. But I expect a GLC coupe as soon as possible, as a smaller brother of the GLE coupe. The GLC got 120 millimeters longer than the GLK, of which 118 centimeters were put in the wheelbase, so we got more space inside and inside the trunk. The color we got here is, by the way, called citrine brown, and it's one of 12 colors you can choose from, and they even offer the same brown in a matte version. The GLC stands by a factory settings on 17-inch alloys. Our model with the exclusive line would stand of would stand on 18-inch alloys, but we got the optional 19-inch here with winter tires, 235/55. We got a ground clearance here of 181 millimeters or 7 inches, and depending on the suspension, the GLC is now available with an air-matic suspension or an air suspension. Then you can get pump the car up while being off-road, even up to, I think, 50 millimeters. Well, I told you it's all more rounded. Same for the rear. We got a roof spoiler here on top, and most significant, I think, are the rear lights. The GLK had really edgy, big, huge rear lights. They are not now much smaller and divided into two parts, where one part stays with a lid, and by the way, full LED rear lights here. Looking a little bit deeper, what we see here in chrome as well as in the front is supposed to be to protect your car from stones and rocks from the ground, supposed to. And we got two exhaust pipes. No, I'm kidding. Those are not exhaust pipes, they're just fake. We got just one exhaust pipe, and it's here below in the rear. The other stuff is just for the looking good part. I told you we have more wheel space now, which means more space in the inside. And I would like to show you as well the new interior of the GLC. The door opens around about 85 degrees here. The neat thing about the SUVs, you sit a little bit higher, and so it's easier to get inside the car, as you can see. And I can reach to the door easily and close it. So welcome in the interior inside the GLC, and yes, you're not wrong, it looks pretty much like the new C-Class inside. Well, a little, just tiny bits differ, like the glove compartment or the way I sit here next to the middle, to the center. However, first thing I notice, you don't get a spacious feeling if you get in here, because the windscreen is pretty close to you. And even so, we have this dashboard here, which is not too small. It's not giving me really the spacious feeling I know from other cars. It's not that you feel like all tightened up or compact, or that it looks like a compact car. However, no spacious feeling. If someone is sitting on the passenger seat, you still have enough space. You feel that you have the space, but it doesn't look like it too much. It's more understatement, I guess. But however, due to the center, which is getting bigger to the top, you have at least the feeling, well, this is mine and this is yours. So you're separated pretty much from the passenger seat. I am 180 centimeters tall, so 5'11". I have no problems in here. I have more head space that I need, more than a fist between my head and the ceiling. And I had no problems finding a good sitting position here for driving, very comfortable. However, you know, Toby, the camera guy, the tall guy, he is 195 centimeters tall, so 6'5". And I would like to invite him to show you how it feels inside the GLC for a tall guy.
Hello guys, thanks Jan. Yeah, it's a pleasure to drive this car. I have lots of headspace, really a lot of headspace. It's nearly 1.5 fists, I would say. And the space between the steering wheel and my legs is nice as well. And yeah, it feels good to drive this car. Everything has the right dimensions for me, and yeah, that's really good. And especially my field of view to the right, I'm always complaining about this, but in this situation the mirror is like on the very high position, and so my field of view is bigger than I'm used to have it, and that's very neat to have. Okay, I think even when you're taller you can drive this car, because you can even move the seat further back than I have it right now, and I think it's a little bit more of space, and even when you're taller you should really be able to drive this car.
Well, thanks Toby. I think all the tall guys have a neat insight now how they sit inside the GLC. Talking about using the car, I'm still, you know, I have no problems with a free floating display. I know a bunch of people hate it because they say it looks cheap, just put on there. But I think it's fine, you know. I don't mind it at all. However, I kind of dislike that it's not facing me, a little bit at least. Same for the whole center. It's all faced, facing center to the rear. And I like cars where I have the feeling that everything is driver oriented. However, everything is in reach, and once you have driven one Mercedes, you will get along in the GLC with ease, I promise. Oh, I didn't say anything about the material. I'm sorry. The whole dashboard is covered with, I think, artificial leather. Don't blame me if it's real leather. However, it feels nice, even on the side of the door. Then we got this alloy plate here, this alloy application, and down here it's all soft touch. Except the door, the lid of the gloves compartment. But this soft touch, here we got this leather, artificial leather again. I'm sitting on leather seats. I got leather in the doors, this wooden application in the door as well. And I told you already up here, it's the same stuff like down there. And all the things, especially the wood, feels very premium. And I have to say, back in time, you know, like 10 years ago, I would never, ever, 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 ever think that I would accept wooden furniture, you know, like wooden application in a car. But nowadays, maybe I grew old, you know, I think it's kind of neat. I like it. And I like it more than this glossy black paint that, you know, comes in every car now. So I think this wooden stuff looks pretty neat in here. Okay, let's start our normal review. You can adjust the safety belts in the height on your shoulder, and the safety belt is this long. I think pretty much enough belt for most people. I'm sitting here on fine leather seats. Fine leather, it's really nice to touch. It's perforated, and you can heat the seat up in three intensities and cool them down as well, both at the same time, by the way. And I enjoy this because I like to have the seat heating on on the highest intensity, and the air condition just on level one, so it's blowing the hot air to me. That's really neat. Try it out if you have a chance to drive in a Mercedes. The seats are really comfortable. It's easy to find a good sitting position because you can adjust them all electrically in any ways. You can even extend the length of the seat cushion here up to 5 centimeters. You can even adjust the headrest electrically, and you have an electric lumbar support as well. And whatever you do, you can save it in three different memory places. The seats are not only comfortable, I've driven, I think, one trip around 200 kilometers, enjoyed the seats very much. They even have side support. And yes, it's an SUV, so not really a sporty car. However, if you drive it sporty, you will enjoy the seats because they're giving you side support. And I know a lot of SUVs where the side support of the seat is just not existent. Okay, talking about the steering wheel, with a leather coat here, and I think it's kind of neat. Okay, we got brown leather on the seats, we got brown artificial or real leather on the dashboard, and they really made the steering wheel with brown leather as well, and even the topping here of the horn is in brown, which looks kind of weird. If you look at it closely because you're not used to, at least we in Germany, not used to brown steering wheels. However, we got shifting pedals, easy to reach, made out of plastic. It's a multifunctional steering wheel, so we got buttons on the left side to control the board computer and on the right side to control the infotainment system. The steering wheel is adjustable electrically as well. So once you've adjusted it, that's very to the very out and the very low. Once you have adjusted it in your preferred way, you can store it up with a storage thing for the seats as well. So that's very up, very in. It's pretty slow, yes, they all are. I don't know why, however they are. But it doesn't matter too much because you don't adjust the steering wheel all the way, all the time. Okay, I had no problems. I like it if it comes out so much. However, I have to say that if I have it in my personal preference position, that the steering wheel covers part of the cockpit, and I don't like this too much. Not too bad here in this car because we have a head-up display, but overall I can't really see how fast I'm going right now if I drive in this position. I really have to put the steering wheel up a little bit, which I don't like too much. Now I see everything, but my arms are actually too high. Well, that's how it is. Okay, I think I covered everything around for the steering wheel. You can order it heated as well, but our car is not equipped with a steering wheel heating. In the mirrors, they're big enough to see everything what's behind. I think they have just the right size for this kind of car. In the rear mirror, I see the whole rear window, so that's good. Even with the headrest up, I can see enough. If I turn my head around my shoulder on the left, there's no blind spot. And on the right, A, B, C, and D pillar, all fine. Actually, the D pillar is not very skinny. However, I don't really feel that there's a big blind spot. What I like is that the headrest of the right seat in the back is in the same angle than the D pillar. So it's not, making a possible blind spot any bigger. But that's fine, I really enjoy it. Besides that, our test car is equipped with a 360-degree camera. So once you put the car in reverse or press a button here on the side, you get the picture, the bird view picture on the left side and the other camera position on the other side. You know, bird view is made out of the picture of four cameras, one in the front, one in the back, and under each mirror cap there's another one. And the CPU calculates it to this bird view picture, pretty neat. And you can choose with on the right size, or if you want to see the rear camera, the front camera, or even the sides. What I have to say about this camera is it's not only working fine during daylight, but as well during nighttime. And I hate those cameras that you have to rely to that give you a really awful picture when it's dark. Here you have a still very crisp picture even during nighttime, and I really enjoy this. Let's have a look at the cockpit. So we have two classical round gauges. I'm sorry. On the left side we have the speedometer going up to 260 kilometers per hour while the car runs 222. In the lower part we even have the control for the fuel tank, and if it's full you see little digits glue here. No, yeah, well, there's, you know, it's illuminated when it's full, and once it's empty the little digits disappear. On the right side we have the RPM meter going up to 6000 RPM with a red range starting at 5000 RPM. In the lower part we have the control for the water temperature, the cooling water. In between the round gauges, we have the display of the board computer. The display is pretty big. Actually, I would say it's even like 5/7 of an iPhone Plus. And in the upper part, you always see the assist systems, the current driving program, and which agility program you is. So C here stands for comfort. In the very lower part, you always see the outside temperature and the time. And in between, we have everything from the board computer. And starting with the trip master, we got the current speed, well, the mileage of the car, fuel consumption and how efficient you're driving, another efficiency display, another board computer from the start of the car and from the last reset. Of the home button, we can choose navigation system, radio, media, telephone, assist systems, service and settings. Just jumping in the system graphics, that's a screen for the active lane keeping assist as well as for the adaptive cruise control. And here we can disable the assist, attention assist. And look at the settings. Here we can turn on and off the assist systems. We can set what we want to see in the head-up display and the brightness and the position, of course. We have a setting for the lights, whatever happens here. And we can do something about the instrument cluster as well. And some overall settings for the vehicle, like the winter tire settings. And we can all restore it to factoring setting as well. In the center, the free floating system by factory setting. We got a 7-inch display. We got the big command online system here. So it is 8.4 inches wide. You can read both systems very nice during day and nighttime. No problems. It's getting a little loud. We have someone here, road construction work. And both systems you can easily read, I told you already, during day and nighttime, and I enjoy it. Besides that, we have a head-up display straight away. Already told you, showed you the settings. I was kind of sad that the speed is just pictured in a small, tiny way. I would appreciate if I could make it a little bit bigger, especially if I say I don't want anything else but the speed here. Okay, we got an ambient light. We can choose between three different colors. And right now I'm showing you how it looks during nighttime. Last but not least, we have a horn and it sounds like this. Well, I just had to scoot a few meters with the car because someone else was trying to work where we are filming right now. So it looks a little bit different here. However, let's look at all the compartments we got here in the GLC, starting with the door panels. Here we got two cup holders actually. The first one in the front is good enough for a small 0.5-liter bottle, and in the second one we even get Toby's 1.5-liter bottle. I have a can here as well, like a small can. You shouldn't put this in the first cup holder because it's just too small and you have to fiddle around with your hands to get it out here there, which is not really good for driving. Going all the way around, nothing here. First compartment is right under this little lid. And here's my new iPhone, by the way. I'm sorry, you know, I do always this comparison. Now it's a new phone, so you have to rethink the whole thing. In here we have a compartment in the rear with an anti-slip surface. By the way, even the doors are covered, the floor of the door compartments are covered with anti-slip surface. Next to it, here in the compartment, we find a 12-volt outlet and two cup holders. Putting the bottle as well as the can in here, the cup holders have spacers, so the both don't shake around. Even the cup holders have an anti-slip surface, which makes sense because you can remove the whole unit of holders and then just have a bigger compartment in here. So if you're not drinking while you're driving, don't drink and drive anyway, you can remove this part and have a little bit more storage in here. My iPhone goes back in here, of course. One button to open them all. Just press one button and both wings open. Here we got another compartment, pretty big inside. Two USB ports and a SD card slot. And some phone installment by Mercedes. I don't know what it's good for. The car has its own data connection, so maybe that's the part in here. I'm pretty happy. They used to put it in the middle, so you couldn't hardly use the storage below it. Now it's on the back of the thing, of the whole compartment, and you still have enough storage for anything else. Down here we have a little net. If there's any Mercedes driver and you have a net down there, please let me know, what are you storing in here? What's it good for? I think it's so point and useless. However, you find it in the new C-Class as well. I'm really curious to know, are you using this? Okay, big difference between the regular C-Class and the GLC is the gloves compartment. In the regular C-Class, you could hardly open it and could hardly reach in. Here we have just the regular lid. It opens up and you have, well, all the storage. By the way, we got this smell thing here. What's it called? Downtone mood. So you can buy different flavors, put it in your car, and the car is supposed to smell in here like downtown mood right now. Well, whatever. The gloves compartment is not really big. This is you know, the instruction and all that. This whole thing does not fit in there. And I'm really asking Mercedes-Benz, is this clever that not only the board materials fits in the gloves compartment? That's too sad. However, you got a pen holder here and the whole thing is illuminated as well. We got two sun shields, both have makeup mirrors that are illuminated by an LED light. The mirror is pretty big too. And a little clip for tickets or whatever on the side next to the mirror. Here's a little compartment for your glasses or sunglasses. It's coated with clothes, by the way. Then we got a reading light for the driver and the passenger. And it's right here, the lights are underneath the mirror. Besides that, we have an entry light or a big light, so five LEDs up here and the two from the mirrors as well. And I even have a button to turn on the lights in the rear or turn them off, whatever I want. We got handles on all four doors and I'm done. That's it from the front. When you're talking about an SUV, I'm talking about a soccer mom vehicle. So let's check out the space in the rear. In comparison to the GLK, the GLC has a little bit less head space. Let's check this out too. But oh, here is enough space. Getting inside is pretty easy as well. Well, I was quite surprised when I got inside the GLC on the rear bench, because look at this. I got more than plenty of head space. It's really, this is feeling spacious here to my head. And even to the side, I have enough space. Nothing is disturbing me. The driver's seat is put in my personal position, and you know I'm 180 centimeters tall, so 5'11", and I have lots of space, really enough space for myself. But interesting to see, how can Toby sit inside here? He is 195 centimeters tall, so 6'5". Okay, please, Toby, show us.
Hello, guys. Thanks, Jan. Yeah, no, I'm sitting here and it's a pleasure, actually. I have enough leg space. I can even move my legs just a little bit. I can move my feet. That's a goodie. And yeah, the head space, I can even put a fist between the ceiling and my head. So that's everything perfectly fine. Even to the sides, I don't feel tightened up at all.
Well, thank you, Toby. We appreciate this. And let's go on here. First of all, I want to mention that the seats are covered with the same leather like the seats in the front. So same material, same luxury feeling. And the door panels are pretty much the same like in the front. Leather, this wooden application, and this artificial leather on the top. And the seats are even formed out a little bit in the back. So I have a tiny bit of side support, which I really highly appreciate. In the door panels, we have space once again for this Toby's 1.5 liter bottle. It fits in here, or just half a liter, whatever you like. And you can even put them all together in here. The rear of the front seats is covered with hard plastic, so you don't harm the driver with your knees. And there even is a little bit place spared out. So if you have people with longer legs, that they can put their knees in here and even have a little bit more of room. Down here it looks like a plate, but actually it's sort of a magazine bag, whatever. So you can even put a decent Harry Potter book in here, I guess. That's pretty amazing. I like this new way of putting the things. In the center we have two air outlets and the controls for the climate control. So we have a 3-zone climate control. And down here we have a little tiny compartment, pretty useless I guess. And I'm wondering why they didn't put any USB or 12 volt outlet in here. It's really a lack, missing. We have an armrest in the center. There's a little compartment. The bottom is covered with clothes once again, and two cup holders, and I like them. You can really easily get them installed here, and they hold as well the bottle as well as this little can pretty nicely, so nothing really happens. And they're quick and fast to be removed as well. If you need to, you can release the whole middle part of the rear bench. So you can flip it 40, 20, 40. And this way you can load through longer goods. For the kids, we got Isofix hooks on both outer seats. The locks of the safety belts are stiff and stable, so kids can buckle up themselves with ease. And the length of the safety belt is plenty of length, so you shouldn't have any problems fixing a baby shelf here or a child seat. Besides that, you can roll down the windows, power driven, and they fold down all the way, which I like. Easy to look out as well. And since it's a Mercedes-Benz, of course, we have a protection so no one gets harmed with fingers or arms stuck in there. Up here we got a reading light for both outer seats. LED reading light, pretty bright light, good for reading, I guess. Over there we got a handle, a little hook for your jacket, another hook to put the net in here to prevent things from falling through. And oh yeah, jumping in the middle. We got a four-wheel drive, so we got a cardan tunnel here. A little bit unhandy. I can sit all right, a little bit harder on the back as well as the cushion is pretty hard too. My legs cover now part of the outer seats. And I'm sitting on the locks of the safety belts. So I can say not enough space on the rear bench for grown-ups, at least for grown-ups my size. All right, before we check out the trunk, here is the key, a regular Mercedes-Benz key. And I think the design didn't change in the last 3 years. So nothing on the rear. On the front, we got the Mercedes-Benz star button to lock the car, to unlock the car, and to open the trunk. So we got various ways to open the lid. First, we got the button here. Second, the key. Third, in the driver's door panel is a little switch. And since we got the easy pack system here, I can put the key just in my pocket and just do this move. All right, first time. First timer. And so the lid opens all electrically. In here we got 80 liters more space than we used to have in the GLK. So now it's 550 liters, which equals 19 cubic feet. And the trunk got up to 150 millimeters wider and gained 40 millimeters in depth. Okay, so our tripod case fits in there easily. Let's look inside. We got a little trapdoor in here. Down there we find the warning triangle, warning vest, the first aid kit and some stuff that I can use to tie up things here. And there's even more space if you want to put something smaller down here. And as an option you can even lock it, you know, so protection for some thieves. On the left side, behind the wheel arch, we have a little compartment divided by a net. On the other side, there's just a tiny compartment, not divided by anything. We got two LED lights here to illuminate the trunk. And there's a 12-volt outlet and two hooks where you can place your shopping bags. Privacy blinds. Well, not as handy, but easy to remove. Just pulling it out. And by the way, up here is another light, red in the back and a white down here. So you got a little bit more light, but that doesn't look like an LED. We got two grips here, both with a little hook for your jacket. And of course the buttons to close the lid again. On both sides we find little buttons, so I can flip the rear seat electrically from the trunk side. They fall 60% in the, no, 40% on the right and 60% on the left. Besides that, there's another little button that I can use to press down the rear of the car, so the air suspensions lowers the back of the car, so I can easily put things in here. So now the trunk between the wheel arches is 108 centimeters, so 42.5 inches wide. And we have a length in here from the start of the trunk to the upper part of the rear bench of 80 centimeters, so 31.5 inches. If I flip the rear bench, I have space for 150 centimeters, so 59 inches. And if I push the passenger seat to the very front, I can load long goods up to a length of 190 centimeters, so almost 75 inches. Ow! Whee! Just two little things. Here is a lock for the rear bench, and I have something else I can pull up here so it's standing out a little bit more. This is called cargo setting, so you have a little bit more space in the trunk. And once again, I have a little push button here as well, not only in the trunk, to flip the backrest. So I can do it either from the trunk side or here from the side. If you flip both rear benches, you have a volumina of 1,600 liters for your luggage, so 57 cubic feet. And you can load up to 655 kilograms or 1,444 pounds inside the GLC, of which you can put 75 kilograms or 165 pounds on the roof. I just measured here for you with the air suspension function. You can lower this part down to 69 centimeters, so 27 inches. If the car is in regular state, it's around about 73 centimeters high, which is 28.5 inches. And if you have a smaller garage, you should know that the lid opens up to a length of 210 centimeters, so almost 83 inches. But be aware that once you lower the lid, by the way, it has a protection here, but once you lower the lid, you can stop it and pressing the button a little while until you hear this noise, this one noise, not the two. This one, the lid is programmed in a way that it's only open to this height. So even if you have a smaller garage, you can program the lid for your needs. If you want to, you can even install a hook. It's good for pulling trailers up to a weight of 2.5 tons if they have their own braking system. I would like to share some of my driving impressions with you here in the Mercedes-Benz GLC 250d. Well, first of all, let's start with this little dynamic agility switch or whatever it's called. I can navigate through the different driving programs, so starting with Eco for efficient driving. Comfort, I would even say the best of all worlds. Sport, Sport Plus, and Individual. And once you hit Individual, you have this button Adapt, and you can see what you can adapt. So we got the powertrain or the drive, the suspension, the steering, the start-stop eco function, as well as a climate control. I'm gonna go back to Comfort now, or even Eco. So I think for a 204 horsepower diesel driving program called Sport Plus, it's a little bit of ambitious. However, well, it's there at least, you know. So once you want to accelerate a little bit faster, you can switch to Sport Plus, since the whole characteristic of the engine is tweaked or tweaked just a little bit. But as I said, 204 diesel horses, don't expect too much. So starting with the steering, I think the steering in Comfort is already neatly direct. So for your, especially for an SUV, it's pretty direct. And I'm driving with adaptive cruise control, so don't worry about my room to the guy in front of me. So the steering, even in Comfort, it's already perfect for me. By the way, I drove in Comfort most of the time because, first of all, I was too lazy to switch the modes all the time. Second, the settings for Comfort is pretty awesome. I think you can use Sport or Sport Plus on the Autobahn, for instance, if you're really going fast. But even then, you don't need it. However, the steering gets a little bit stiffer in Sport. In Sport Plus, it's the same setting like in Sport. But actually, I didn't need it. I think steering is perfect for your normal driving. On one hand, in the city, it's pretty easy to navigate in all the parking spots. You have a pretty big car. Well, not for North America, but for the rest of the world, this is a pretty big car. And getting into a parking spot is still pretty easy because of the neat steering we have here. And once you put it in Sport, it gets a little bit stiffer. So once again, for driving on the Autobahn, you might want to activate Sport or Sport Plus, but it's really not that necessary. In contrast to the suspension, because the suspension in Comfort is really comfortable. It is, especially when we talk about SUVs, you know, normally SUVs are a little bit more stiff, a little bit more rougher from the suspension. Here you got this air suspension, and it's really sweet and gives you a comfortable ride. And once you put it in Sport or Sport Plus, it gets stiffer, of course, and you feel more about the condition of the road. However, the seats are very comfortable, and even if you put it in Sport Plus, it's never an uncomfortable ride. But if you drive in Comfort, it's the best setting for really you know, long time cruising, long making a lot of mileage with the car. And that's why I preferred Sport, Comfort. The 9G-tronic automatic transmission provides seamless shifting in each program you choose. And I'm really pleased about the 9 gears you got now, because more gears means less RPM. So the whole drive is more silent overall. And I've nothing to complain about the 9G-tronic at all. Talking about noises in the car, it's a little bit windy outside today, so you hear more wind noises than you're supposed to hear from the driving wind. However, I'm driving 120 kilometers per hour now, and I can, you know, talk normally to you guys. accelerating up to 140 now. So that's 140. The wind noise gets a little bit louder, but not really that loud that I have to raise my voice. And now, just for the fun of it, I'm going into Sport Plus. I'm pushing the throttle. Well, dude, get out of my way. See, that's the point, driving on the Autobahn. You guys think no speed limit, oh yeah, yeah. But then you have people like him, you know, who not look in the rear mirror and let other people pass. I bet he's still not sure. Oh, no, oh well. Okay, so accelerating, pushing the throttle really to the bottom. Now we have 160, so 100 miles per hour, 170, 180. Let's leave it with 180 for now. Still, you know, I guess I'm raising my voice just a little bit. You hear more wind noises, of course, but overall it's an SUV, so if you don't hear wind noises, something is wrong, I guess. I'm going 170 now, so I think you can still say it is a pretty silent drive. One thing, I'm going 190 kilometers per hour now. It's just 204 diesel horses, so I'm pressing the throttle all the way. And acceleration, if you're going already faster than 160, it's a little bit hard. Takes a while to get to 200, which I just passed now. 207, 208. It's really creepy up here now. But just the steering itself, you know, steering and the suspension, the whole handling of the car on 200 kilometers per hour, while driving 200 kilometers per hour, is really fine. Pushing the brakes now, going down to 120. So it's easier to talk. The brakes, however, you know, I have nothing to complain about the brakes at all. They don't seem to have any problems with the weight of the car. Might be interesting to have to test the brakes with a trailer, but overall I can't complain about anything. Well, summing it all up, we have 204 diesel horses, so it's not a race car. However, up to 180 kilometers per hour is a good speed for traveling long distance. Even the car runs fine with the speed, and well, if you drive a little bit slower, you of course save a lot of fuel, but the car is doing it, and that's my point. It's very comfortable from the suspension, from the seats, and steering and suspension are fine even on the Autobahn. I've really nothing really to complain. Maybe talking about fuel consumption, here we doubled whatever Mercedes told us the car would consume. But yeah, overall it's an SUV. They always like to have some diesel. The car's equipped with various assist systems. We have a traffic sign recognition, a little camera there scans the road for traffic signs, which works with charm. On the left side next to the steering wheel, we can enable or disable the DTR plus steering assist and the lane keeping assist. It's an active lane keeping assist. If you're just driving regularly, it doesn't support you while driving, but at least it warns you once you cross the lines, gives you a little sign in the center display, and you feel something in the steering wheel. And once you cross the line on the right, it even slows down the car and gives you this little thing. Once you enable the Distronic Plus adaptive cruise control, the lane keeping assist starts being active. So if I, you know, pull the steering wheel a little bit to the side, it's all steering by itself. Yes, I'm always keeping my hand on the steering wheel. It's not that I don't trust the car. I just want to, you know, look around and there are other traffic going on. So all the systems work fine, work with charm, and I hope they get so reasonable priced anytime soon that everyone can profit from those nice systems. There's a head-up display as well in our car. it shows the current speed. Once you activate the active cruise control, it shows you which speed you want to drive and the current speed limit. Whenever you use the navigation system, the GPS system, it gives you the instruction here as well. So you never have to lower your eyes, and I like it. It's nice, it's good. I like the one from BMW a little bit better, even I'm a Mercedes fanboy. I would love them to make a function if I only want to see the speed, which I can tell the system to do so in the board computer, that the speed would be a little bit bigger. Now it's okay size, but it could be bigger, and that would be nice. Talking about the command online system, as a Mercedes fanboy, I like it, of course. It's neat. However, it's a little bit of toying around, you know, all these animations, especially if you go like here on the radio or using the media stuff. I actually, from the navigation or, you know, the usability of the system, I would prefer BMW by now because it's more structured, more simple. However, this one is neat to look at. They have all the nice icons here, and I appreciate this as well. We got the Burmester premium sound system in here, and I like it. It's really good. It's at least in my ears, it feels much better than the system from the C-Class, from the sedan of the C-Class, or even the coupe. Maybe it's the same system, but this one sounds much better to me. Maybe it's the overall acoustic in this car here that makes it sound so good. But it's worth the extra money, of course, for sure. Oh, and last but not least, I almost forgot, we got a blind spot warner. So once the radar recognizes the car in the rear that is coming in your blind spot, a little warning triangle flashes up in the mirror. And if you put the turning signal indicator in this direction, it even flashes and gives you a little beep. Well, coming to an end of our review, it's time to sum up for me. I start with the most significant value in our review. Mercedes-Benz claims a fuel consumption of 5.5 liters. We say, not exactly, Mercedes. We had a fuel consumption on over 1,200 kilometers of 10.3 liters. So we almost doubled the value. And I promise, as I'm standing here, I promise, I swear, that we didn't go crazy with the car at all. I mean, it's a 250d, a diesel with 204 horses, so it's not a sporty ride anyway. And well, we had a lot of city limit traffic, and when we went on the autobahn, we drove a little bit faster, but since we have speed limits all around Bielefeld by now, we couldn't drive like hell fast, you know. So I'm not sure why we wasted so much gas. I could imagine you can drive a little bit more efficient, but for some reason we were not able to, and I'm kind of wondering. That's quite a difference. Okay, driving fun. Well, it is an SUV, and I'm not an SUV friend or fan, so I would basically say no driving fun at all. I mean, it's an SUV. But for an SUV with a 4MATIC, with a great steering, and with the suspension, you can indeed have lots of fun while driving. So I say sum up, and Toby is saying yes. Talking about comfort, I like the seats, they're highly comfortable, and so is the air suspension. Both together give you a really comfortable ride, even for an SUV, so both sums up. Use it as a daily driver. For a grown-up my size can drive in here easily. Even a Toby with his 195 centimeters 6'5 can sit in the rear behind me at least. You have a huge trunk as well that is easy to fill. So I say yes, as a daily driver, sums up for sure. All in all, even so, it's not my favorite Mercedes I would say it's a neat car. I'm not too much into SUVs. Just a little story. Yesterday night I was driving home from the office home, you know. I was standing for a longer time on a traffic light. And I was just, you know, seat heating was like really nice and cozy. And I was looking at the dashboard and saying, oh yeah, I like you. Oh, you're my Mercedes. You know, what a Mercedes fanboy does if he's standing on a red traffic light. And then I was going all crazy. Damn, Jan, it's an SUV. What the hell you think you're thinking? Okay, so I got all my, you know, senses together and said, well, yeah, it's not bad for an SUV. And that's what I say. I like it. It's a nice SUV overall. And compared to the X3 and the Audi Q5, I think it's one of the nicer ones. Okay, that's it from my side. If you have any questions, please feel free and invited to ask us in the comments field. We're trying to answer every comment. Sometimes it takes a little while. If you want to do something good for us, tell your colleagues, your friends, your mates and your family about us. We want to grow and we need more viewers. And you can, of course, share our clips on Facebook, Twitter or Google+. And even you putting our video and your personal playlist on YouTube will help us grow and be more visible. Okay, if you think, man, these Germans, they're cool, they're good, I want more from them, you can even support us in a financial way, send us money. We offer Patreon and TPS services so you can make sure we won't disappear. And overall, that's it, I guess. I hope you enjoyed the show. My name is Mr. Z. My English is however, I hope you tune back in next time when it's again Ausfahrt.tv in English. So long.